Hey guys, welcome back to Weld.com. So today I have John Thompson with Ferd here with me. In a previous video, we did some weld discontinuities, how to avoid them. But if you've been welding in the field or in the shop for any amount of time, you know that it's inevitable. You're going to end up with a weld discontinuity. So we went ahead and replicated that. I put a root in here with some intentional lack of fusion. And I wanted to talk to John about some of the ways I can get rid of this so that I can get back on track, put that weld back in and keep going. Obviously, I can't just weld over that because the lack of fusion is there. I'm just going to cover it up if I continue to weld. So what I have to do is remove that section of weld and just do a tie-in and fill that pass in. So, John, throughout my experience, most of the job sites I've been on, I've only had access to these three wheels. So I have a quarter-inch hard rock, a zerk wheel, and a cutoff wheel. Over the years, I've learned that it is not appropriate to use a quarter-inch hard rock, you know, especially since I started talking to folks in the abrasive industry. You're not supposed to use a quarter-inch hard rock on here. Zerk wheel's out of the question because I can't get access. I don't have any abrasive material on the outside of this wheel. And the 045 cutoff wheel, it's like digging a big hole with a teaspoon. So that leaves me with the quarter inch hard rock. And this is typically what I've seen a lot of people use, and you end up and deteriorate that edge because that's not the purpose of this wheel. So tell me why I can't use this in this situation, and then tell me what you would come up with that would be the appropriate abrasive for this. So, you know, the viewers at home, they'll know exactly what they should be using.
You have to make the adjustment on the way the wheel's designed. Realistically, the cutoff wheel is designed to cut, mm-hmm. but it's so thin, especially in an 045 cutoff wheel, that as you said, you can't get enough profile to get it away. You'll make a bunch of little cuts, but right. It won't really work for you. Obviously, the segmented flap disc, or you call it the zerk wheel, nothing wrong with that, but that's really designed to run flat. There's really nothing on the side
right.
to wear things out. So in reality, it won't let you get in to where you want to be able to go. But here's the difference that comes. This is a grinding wheel.
Right.
All right. However, most of the time what you're using it for is you're using it to take off some scale, and you're using it to prep the plates by pushing this product. You're using it to prep the paints, the plates to put the bevel on that you want. And that's what it's designed to do. This wheel's designed to work between 15 and 30 degrees. So when you're pushing this into place, your body naturally will put it that way. So it's reinforced at the top, the middle, and the bottom so that the wheel itself will give you excellent wear life and allows you to give you a very aggressive and safe wheel to use. But it's reinforced in the middle as well as the top and the bottom. When you try to go on edge with this, what happens is now you start to fight it and the wheel itself can break down. But you need to grind. So we've got to give you a grinding wheel, not a cutoff wheel, not a flap disc, not a thick grinding wheel. We have to give you a wheel that's designed to grind on edge. And this is where the eighth inch wheel is designed to be able to do. This is reinforced on the outsides. You can see a reinforcement layer right here. Mm-hmm. It's also reinforced here. And this grain is packed so that it's designed to come in. It's thicker than the cutoff wheel. So it tends to take a wider, so it won't bury itself in real deep. It tends to take a wider
amount
of
material.
It's got a
wider berthing area in there.
Exactly. The other aspect behind it is that it's intended to grind on edge, so to come in, it'll fit into where you want it to be. Mm-hmm. Now, this is pretty wide, and that's where a lot of guys, too, will turn around and say, well, I need the wide wheel because I got a lot of weld I got to get out. That's what your arms are for. Mm-hmm. In reality, what your arms are for is to take this wheel, turn the grinder a little bit so that you're actually riding on the bevel, just outside of the bevel, and scoop this out. Now, instead of just the thickness of the wheel, because you've got it turned, you'll actually wind up with a wider face. In this case, you're going to pull because you want the control. If you push, you're going to keep falling into here. So you don't push it like you did with your quarter inch wheel. You pull it, so you take the crown off of the bad spot, then a little farther down, pretty soon you get it all even, open it up a little bit, and now you've got a nice shallow bed to lay in your other wells. That's what the eighth inch wheel's for.
We'll go ahead and hook it up to the grinder, and we'll go ahead and clean it out. Okay, so right up here I had like a high spot, so I went ahead and just took care of that while I was in here. But the left-hand side of the weld was tied in good to the left side of the plate. It left me an opening on the right hand. So I couldn't get access with that welding rod. So like John was saying, Even though this is an eighth inch wheel, it's designed to run on the edge of that wheel. I can turn it to the side and kind of open up and give myself a little bit wider of an area versus trying to use a quarter inch wheel that's not made for this and just force it in there to get that profile. So I was able to get in there, clean everything back down to the backing strip, and now I'll just go ahead and do a restart, and then I'll do a termination up here. Okay, so we went ahead and made the repair, got rid of that lack of fusion on the sides there. I'm just about brought up to where I was on my initial root pass. So now I can go ahead and do my intermediate fills, and then I can go ahead and cap it right after that. So pretty much that's how you would repair that. You want to cut out that old weld, the bad weld, gain access to it, put you another pass in there so you can tie back into the backing strip, get all three pieces, the left side, right side, left side, right side, and the backing strip all tied back in again. Then just go ahead, run your intermediates or your fill passes, and then you should set yourself up for a cap. Since we're talking about abrasives, you just want to make sure you're using the right product. If you use that quarter inch wheel on the edge, which it's not designed for, you're going to end up with problems. At that point, it could split, incur excess vibrations, throwing the wheel off balance. So you don't want to do that. Use the appropriate wheel for the task at hand. If you don't have the right stuff, go get it. All right, I know what you're going to say. I got this big old crater right here, but I'm not worried about that because when I come back through here and run my intermediate or my fill passes, all that's going to get covered up. It's going to blend in smooth. I'm going to tie in there. I'll have enough penetration to get in there and dig all that stuff out and put two good welds right over top of it, and then I'll be ready for a cap. So I don't even have to worry about this because I hate saying it's going to get covered up, but this whole area right here is going to disappear. If that was porosity, lack of fusion, slag inclusion, I would not leave that here. But because it's just a crater for a tie-in, I'm not worried about it. Once I put those fill passes in there, it's all going to melt in. All right, next up, we have a fillet weld. It's another common joint everybody should be used to. We went ahead and did about 3/4 of the weld correct, meaning 50% of the weld is tied on either side of the plate. And then the last side, I went ahead and put in unequal leg length. So I just picked that work angle up a little bit higher than I needed to and have more of the weld on the horizontal plate than I do on the vertical. John, I want to cut that last probably 25% of that weld out or 35% of that weld out so I can do a tie-in, do a restart and a tie-in and finish that back off to where I have an equal bead throughout the whole piece. What would be the best abrasive that we have here to get rid of that?
Again, you've got to control how you're going to be taking material.
Mm-hmm.
So in essence, you're still going to be using an edge grinding wheel. Because if you come in and such with a cutoff wheel again, that you've got, it's just too thin.
Right.
You're going to wind up undercutting, you're going to wind up with taking parent material that you don't want to take. If you come with the segmented flap disc or the zerk wheel, what you're going to wind up really succeeding in doing is you'll be able to knock this down and get it flush, but you'll have a lot of overgrind in the area. You're going to have a lot of other issues and such cosmetically to work with.
Mm-hmm.
And this is still not intended for you to come in on edge because you're still positioning yourself where what you really want to do is you don't have enough here to be able to use the wheel. You, if it was all you had in the box, you could come at the top, cock it, and push your way through and work with it. The problem, again, that you're going to run into, though, is the edge of the wheel is going to be doing possibly some undercut. Coming back in with this eighth-inch wheel, what you're going to have is you're going to have the advantage of being able to come through here, and you're going to be able to literally come at an angle
and use that edge
so that you clear the clamping nut and clear the, and you're going to be able to just scoop that out of there and be able to pull it through. Because remember, you push this so you can control it that way.
Let's go ahead and give it a shot.
You've got the rotation of the wheel and you're using the edge of the wheel. You'll notice that this, because it's designed to be ground on the edge, you'll notice it's not beveling it like you would with a quarter inch wheel. So you're not winding up with this feathered edge up at the top. This is still keeping its shape. So coming down here and coming into that weld the way you did, you're taking the convex part of the weld and you're turning it flat again. You're getting it out so that the material's in. Also, by staying with the weld area, that's it, your parallel line that you've created cosmetically does not exceed the original line that you clean the scale off with. So you're taking this wheel, you're using the edge, you took the convex part of it, took the crown off, and started to make it concave, and then started to just scoop it out. You also didn't undercut. If you look at both the top and the bottom, you have control here that you don't undercut. And that's usually a big problem, because now all you're going to do is weaken that upper area when you go to weld again anyway. That's why you have control with a wheel designed for edge grinding. As you'll notice that you did not go past your original clean area, which means after you've welded, cosmetically, that whole line's going to look the same. And that's why you want to use a wheel that you can use that much of the edge for.
Okay, so I went ahead and dished this out right back into this area. This is probably about where I made the transition earlier to get that on equal leg length. So I took it back just a little bit further. I got a nice little dish in here, kind of like a, I would want a crater when I do my tie-ins. That way, I don't get any cold lap in there. So I went ahead and dished that out. So I've got this area. I'm going to start the electrode right about here. Tie back into here. Once the puddle washes over where I left that grinding area, I'll continue on and complete the joint. Okay, so you can see I got the tie-in right here. Everything else went pretty smooth. It's nice having the right tools to work with, having the right discs at your disposal. I've used other wheels to cut welds out before, and you end up making a lot more problems than you need to deal with. So just by switching out and using the appropriate disc, you know, something you can actually grind on the edge with, you're not only going to prolong the life of your abrasives, but you know, you're going to get better results with your welding as well. All right, so we've talked about weld repair a little bit, getting into the different types of wheels, but let's talk about, let's change gears a little bit, and let's talk about base metal preparation. So I'm out in the field, I don't have access to a plasma cutter or oxy fuel torch. I have to put a bevel on a piece of plate, I have to take off the mill scale. What would be the best products or the type of abrasive to use for this application?
Okay, well now you've got actually two different challenges. Challenge number one is mill scale itself. Mm-hmm. Mill scale, there's a 100% adhesion. Mill scale actually comes up when you have the billet material, and when it hits oxygen is when it forms the scale. So it is in every nook and cranny on this whole surface. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will come in and stuff and say, well, if I can wear off the mill scale, and you'll see it sometimes when you first grind on it, you get it like a shiny black, and then later on you break through and it gets shiny silver, and then you break through again and break through again. What you're literally doing is you're literally trying to buff your way through with that. The challenge you run into with that is that it takes forever. So you're also trying to bevel a plate. Now, the nice thing about beveling a plate or taking off even some plasma dross is that you can take material because you're trying to set up stock. Mm-hmm. And so on a plate like this, for instance, we're going to go back to the quarter inch depressed center grinding wheel. Realistically, what you've got is you've got a conglomeration or of grain that's pointed in all different directions. It's not oriented in one direction like what you have when you have a coated abrasive material. We had an earlier video, almost a year and a half ago, about coming in and showing taking off mill scale with the epitome of the disc, and that's getting a grinding wheel, quarter inch, made for concrete. Because what that contains is silicon carbide. Instead of the impact grain of coming down with aluminum oxide or zirconia or even ceramic, what you do is it picks it off. It literally comes and one or two passes, all that mill scale is removed. And if you want a bevel, you've got a quarter inch grinding wheel. It's designed especially for taking the top of the material, but if you want to bevel with it, you can bevel with it.
Let's go ahead and get into it. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take off about 1 inch of this mill scale using that quarter inch hard rock on both sides. And then I'm going to switch over to that the Zerk wheel, the 40 grit, and I'm going to try to put a 37.5 degree bevel on there, and we'll just go ahead and double check it with the protractor. All right, so as you can see with that quarter inch wheel, I used a push technique to get everything off, all that mill scale's off on both sides. I'm now going to use the Zerk wheel, and I'm going to do a pull technique and try to get to that 37.5 degree bevel. There you go, not too bad. A little bit more, and I think we're within a half a degree or so. All right, guys, hope you're able to learn some additional information about abrasives. I know John's taught me a lot today. There's a bunch of things that I didn't know that Thanks for taking the time to shed some light on this stuff. I know welding, abrasives are, you know, whatever's on the grinder, I'm going to use it to the best of my ability and try to get what I can out of it. So hope you guys enjoyed the video, learned some stuff about doing some weld repairs as well as beveling your own plates at home. I want to thank John for coming out here and giving us all this great information. Go ahead, drop something in the comments down below. Make sure you like and subscribe to the channel. Until next time, make every weld better than your last.